as a community organiser in 2012, and the area that I looked after was London and the east of England. And my job was basically to sort of support the campaigns, resource those campaigns, give people backup in community campaigns about the most important issues that were affecting them now, to try and get positive outcomes. And of course, the issue that very quickly came up across most of the people I was working with was housing in one way or another, whether that was bedroom tax reforms or changes to housing benefit, which meant that people couldn't afford their rent. But what was happening very significantly in London was regeneration projects of council estates and a very sort of big concerted programme essentially to demolish council estates, move social housing tenants out, doing this in partnership with private developers, and basically replacing social homes with homes for private rent or private sale at extremely high costs, which would never be sort of available or accessible to the kinds of people who lived there before. And that was the context, really, that I met Edwin Deffen, who is the guy who wrote the Grenfell Action Group blog. We'd set up, and Edwin was one of the people who got involved very, very early. We set up a group called Radical Housing Network, which joined up different housing campaigners from across London to support each other, to share resources, to back each other up in campaigns, and occasionally come together and do big joined-up campaigns. And so I've worked on, you know, a number of regeneration campaigns and seen, you know, so many people, but essentially communities being completely disrupted and families being moved out of the areas that they've lived in all of their lives. And we would fight these, and the best that we could really hope for, we know that regeneration private development machine was too big for us to fight, but the kind of things we could get or could hope to achieve was fighting for those people who were removed from those properties to be rehoused in that area, hopefully. You know, and so those were the kinds of goals we were looking at. When Eddie asked me to help with the refurbishment at Grenfell, it was actually the first refurbishment or major works programme rather than an actual regeneration that I'd become involved in. And there's quite a long and detailed story. I'll try and sort of just focus on the bits that are important. I immediately, very, very quickly saw that the problems in that building were hugely important, and they were hugely important to most people in that building. So there's sort of a very simplistic way that you look at campaigning, say for instance in a community organising or union organising campaign, and that's like, is it widely felt, is it deeply felt, and is it winnable? And immediately I saw this campaign, and we had just under 100 people in the little community room downstairs on a weeknight when football was on, after people had come home from work. And immediately, you know, this is really, really important to these people. And that first evening, I heard this background. So first of all, the horrible background of how they'd been treated in the past, and particularly around fire safety. So these very concrete examples of things that had happened in the past, and their real, real, genuine concern about their fire safety. Then there were the things that we decided to tackle at the time, which we focused on these boilers. And then the third thing was how these people had been treated for a very long time by local government, and then how they were being treated by those contractors, who were just, as they carried out works, treating them very, very, very poorly. And I think what happened to Eddie, who was a very, very brave person and who fought for a long, long time, and I've heard a number of times in the community since then, was that people slightly regretful that he didn't have as much support from the community as they now wish that they'd given him. He fought pretty much on his own for years and years and years, alerting anybody who would listen to facts that he knew were true in the face of local government and politicians who deliberately set out to attack him as an individual in order to silence him, in order to discredit him, in order to that they could continue behaving as they were for their own gain. And over the past over the past 10 years, you know, this period, 8 years of austerity, we've seen in the past the background to all of this, you know, which the privatisation of what was social property and what we previously owned and what were public goods, gradually over the last 40 years and then very, very intensely in the last 10 years. And I think what's very, very interesting for me in kind of an objective way now to look at in Kensington and Chelsea is because you can actually see the human beings that are involved in those relationships. So we talk about class, and we talk about how there's been a shift in the balance of power and the balance of wealth over the past 40 years. And it seems like, if you were to study it, it's an abstract thing. Well, here are the wealthy classes. You know, here's the profit-making class, and here's the working class. And you look at what's happened in Kensington and Chelsea, and you can identify the individuals and the organisations, and you can see the actual consequence of what that means when ordinary people are disempowered for the benefit of people whose only goal, only motivation is their own self-enrichment and their own greed. And so I've seen for a long time in my time campaigning, particularly in housing in London, people's lives being destroyed slowly. People's well-being, their health, people actually, I've worked a lot with welfare recipients, so people actually literally dying. But over a longer period and more slowly, people's life chances being minimised and children who should be being brought up in healthy environments where they can thrive because of the kind of stress, financial, personal stress, that they and their families are put into, that those options for them are just so limited. And then I think what's interesting in Grenfell is that we have seen that in such an intense sort of one-off sort of event, but it was just a symptom of what was happening anyway. Yeah, and I think, you know, that's it.